So good morning, everyone. Happy November 21st, which gets us, believe it or not, to episode number 80. So for those new, and I have been having, good morning, Jay. I've been having interesting conversations with people over the past week. For those that are new to this, this is something that I've been doing a long time. It's just a continuation of the disruption topics that I've always talked about. I'm just doing it weekly now. So every Sunday morning, if you care to join, that's when I tend to do it. For those that may want to go back and look at the past recordings, you can go to my YouTube page, which is youtube.com/keeppace. And if you go to playlists, you'll see this one, that Digital Disruption Playlist. And I haven't had a chance to upload. I'm a little bit behind again, but that's not unusual. Just when I get time, I upload them. So again, for those that are new, this is basically taking my reading or things that caught my attention over the week. Sometimes it's influenced by the quote unquote wow factor, but I really like to get past the wow factor and really start finding those nuggets of information, either at a big picture view or a detailed view, that give at least some insights or at least get us thinking a little bit differently about the disruptions that are going to come or that are here. And this week was kind of an interesting week because it was it wanted to fit into the potpourri. It initially started like it was going to be the potpourri box or potpourri episode of a whole bunch of little things. And then as you're going to see, there were certain linkages that as I started putting this together, I said, boy, these linkages kind of these articles linked together. So the first one was a Facebook article. And a lot of different things that I liked about this, because we've heard about virtual reality forever. And there's been a lot of different ways to do it. One way is with, you know, the goggles. Then there's augmented reality where you put the glasses on and it projects, you know, some information or some details about where you're at. And, you know, one of the challenges is that you've at least accomplished the visual piece with virtual reality, but now they're looking to introduce touch. And, you know, if you can now introduce the ability of touch, it becomes a much more immersive experience, because not only are you seeing it and potentially hearing it, you're now touching it. What I found interesting about this particular article, And again, I copied this just from the beginning, because if you look at this particular article, and we're not going to go through the whole thing, this is a fairly lengthy read. I would say to you, this is at least 20 to 30 minutes of your time. And it's some good stuff in here. And I'm going to show you a picture that I thought was pretty amazing. But one of the things I learned here that I did not know about was that Facebook in March of this year began a three-part series exploring the future of human-computer interaction. They laid out a 10-year vision of a contextually aware AI-powered interface for augmented reality, glasses that can use the information you choose to share to offer proactive assistance, allowing us to look up and stay present with those around us. Then they went into some nearer-term research, wrist-based input combined with usable but limited AI, which dynamically adapts to you and your environment. And then they conclude with this haptic glove research, and haptic is it vibrates when you're next to something, you're getting a sensation, and the advances in soft robotics, micro fluidics, hand tracking, haptic rendering, and perceptual science that work entails. The work these researchers, engineers, and designers are doing is long-term research and development. In fact, it's so novel that they are, in some cases, inventing entirely new domains of scientific research. The resulting technologies have the potential to not only fundamentally alter the course of augmented and virtual reality, but to potentially influence fields such as medicine and space travel. Now the thing, good morning, Brian. Now the thing I wanted you to pull out of this, and again, this gets us, this is how we go from that quote unquote wow factor, which is, you know, there's kind of some wow in the article, but getting into if it impacts you directly, and sometimes it's not obvious how it does that, but if we go down, you start seeing how they start thinking about how humans interact with the world. And I can imagine that there's certain things that they might be able to do for, you know, you know, they talk about individuals that are lonely as an example. And if you can now give them an environment where they can actually begin, you know, having other sensations to allow them to participate, I think that's an amazing idea. But digging into this, what caught me from the article, and again, for those that follow this, you know, the first one was that they had a 10-year vision. Now, it's not to say that everybody's vision is right, but what it does is it begins to give you that foresight as to what are people thinking about and what are they experimenting with. And the question becomes, does any of that relate to what you're doing? So that's kind of part one. And then part two, as you go down to it, and I'm not going to play it here, but if you go, well, I'll play it for a second, maybe you can see it. But if you can see this, all these little bubbles are coming up, and this is all plastic, so they don't have the mechanical actuators. They're actually doing this, I think, with fluids and air and whatever it is, but they're showing you that they can they've been able to figure out ways of getting that sensation down to something that's going to be A, lightweight, and B, manageable. So again, I thought it was more of one of these articles that sometimes it's not immediately useful per se, but you start, it begins the journey for you to start sniffing around to say, well, wait a minute, am I interested in this? Is this a skill I should be focused on? What types of companies may be doing this? So again, it's that early research of if you're trying to figure out what you want to do next, these are the types of articles that provide kind of that vision. And then you can start saying to yourself, well, how real is this and how real isn't this? Personally, I think this whole concept of the human-computer interface is a real thing. How it might be able to be used in different populations, I think, is going to be a thing. Now, is this something that's going to happen tomorrow? Probably not. But again, if you're into engineering as an example, this might be something you want to align with. So that was really the first one. It's going to bleed into, I think, the next one, if I'm not mistaken. So the next one got into business. And again, I said earlier, this was potpourri. And what I found interesting about this was for marketers, the title alone caught me. Marketers should prepare for the great demographic disruption. Now, in this particular one, they're really talking about how our society is becoming older, and the fact that people are living longer kind of shapes this curve where they talk about it being the triangle where, you know, the older you got, the lesser your population became. And what they're saying is that's not necessarily going to be true going forward. And one of the things that it does is it got into this whole the ability to have the growth in wearables to be able to do all of this type of tracking and interaction, which is kind of how it bled into the Facebook one. They're looking at this to be a market of $120 billion by 2028, which is really around the corner. So, you know, this ability to figure out where wearables fit and the types of opportunities that creates, you know, I think falls into that whole 10-year vision. They're seeing the democratization of knowledge of one's own body with tech enabling consumers to take a more active and regular role in their own healthcare. Now, again, if you think about that, right, the elderly historically tend to, you know, as you get older, you tend to need more medical assistance. So the ability to have these tools early could be a net positive. Then they talked about the next stage will be to optimize our organs, turbo boost our cognitive functions, and fine tune our genetics. Now, it's kind of all scary stuff, right? We will upgrade our bodies when they begin to wear out. You know, this individual gerontologist predicts the next two decades, humans will reach what he coined longevity escape velocity, meaning the longer we live, the more likely we are to be alive, to use groundbreaking technologies to extend our lifespans earlier. So again, if you're in the medical field and you're going to be probably interacting much more with technology. So I doubt you're going to be a purist if you're a doctor. You're going to have some knowledge of these technical advances, as it were. So, you know, as you start reading through this, it's just interesting dynamics. I mean, one of the ones they talk about here is just this whole thing that Japan got a head start on this. Jeez. 20, 30 years ago when Honda was looking at Asimo robot, and they really understood that as their population got older, they were going to need caregivers, which is where a lot of the Asimo stuff came out of, but we're probably going to see more robotics. So getting that understanding as to the different opportunities that it provides, again, this just screams to me. You know, it's a big market. There's real money, $120 billion by 2028. And again, it's a short article, but again, it's just giving you that sense of what might this roadmap be for the space or the area that I'm in. Now, the next two get us into this, I'll put it into this whole, the impact that government can have and the types of partnerships or collaborations that you can expect to see. Now, this particular one caught my attention for two reasons. Number one, about 5 years ago, I guess, 5-6 years ago, when I was doing a lot more AI work, one of the things I noticed was that Canada was setting up a lot of different opportunistic environments, as it were, where it was a collaboration between government, industry, and academia. And what they were basically trying to do was recreate this kind of Silicon Valley environment, as it were, up in Canada. And they had a couple of different quote-unquote hot zones. And what was very interesting to see was this collaboration, again, between government, academia, and then business. And what I saw in this particular article about Mississippi, it doesn't really have to be about Mississippi, but it was, got me basically to that same, I saw the same types of things where this one, it just says, you know, they're trying to adapt to this new disruptive economy away from agriculture and manufacturing. It's driven by a high level of cooperation between the public sector, education, and private investors. You know, Innovate Mississippi is a robust incubator for startups. And then, you know, it says here, in the high-stake competitive world of academia, it's rare that universities collaborate as closely as they do. And I think that's one of these other talents or other skills that are going to be necessary in the years ahead. I think we're going to see much more collaboration than we do silos. So, you know, a couple things I pull out of this particular article. Number one, you know, you can always look out of state to find out what states are trying to, you know, create these new, you know, technological hubs, as it were. That's one. Number two, what I would suggest is when you look at these, the more collaboration you see, you probably want to be drawn to that, because where people are collaborating, in a sense, it's a form of networking. And I would say that will give you insights as to other, you know, job opportunities, in a sense, simply because you're surrounding yourself with a bunch of like-minded people that are looking to foster, you know, a given product, service, whatever. So, you know, I'm not sure how many states are doing this. I'm sure they're all doing it in some way, shape, or form. This one just happened to be much more formalized, or at least from this particular article. And this was actually back from September. So again, this is a relatively quick read, but it gives you, you know, the different startups, what they're trying to do. And again, just a good article to get you thinking differently about where do you want to work, the types of sectors that you want to be in, and looking for these areas that are looking to collaborate across a wide range of either companies or educational institutions. And again, if you look up, if you do Canada and AI, you will find about 5-6 years ago, you'll find very similar articles. So this is why this particular one caught my attention. Next. Now this one gets interesting. And there these last two that I had for you today. Oh, I hate this. Okay. How do I get off it? Thank you. So this was a new one. And when was this dated? This was just dated November 17th. So I just saw this the other day. Chinese data laws are adding to global shipping disruption. So one of the things we've talked about, you know, many times is this concept of regulation, Well, remember that regulation is worldwide, right? It's not necessarily US-based. So in this one, it says ships in Chinese waters are disappearing from tracking systems following the introduction of a new data law in China, frustrating efforts to ease bottlenecks that are snarling the global economy, according to three shipping sources. Although there are no specific guidelines on shipping data in the regulations, some domestic providers in China have stopped giving information to foreign companies as a direct consequence of the new rules. The data is relied upon to provide information on cargo volumes and helps optimize logistics by predicting congestion so companies can make key decisions on shipping routes. Now, as you might guess, with our supply chain problems and with a lot of manufacturing being moved overseas, you might see why this is a problem. But it gets back into this, you know, when we talk about what's your value proposition and what do you bring to the table, this whole ability to understand what those dynamics are across multiple countries, the ability to build those relationships to get a better understanding as to what the concerns are and, you know, ideally trying to figure out solutions to get around them. So, you know, I think that this is going to be an interesting one that I think we're going to see more in the coming days. Again, this one just came out, again, what did I say, on the 17th? Just came out on the 17th. I haven't seen anything else on this, but I thought it was just interesting just because of the supply chain issues that we've talked about, number one. But it gets us back to that whole, you know, when you're having those conversations, you really can't be myopic on a singular skill anymore. It really gets into this whole ecosystem. And if you're in supply chain, understanding the data laws, it seems, is going to become a new skill set that you're going to need in order to be, you know, ahead of the pack, as it were. So this whole concept of regulation, you know, rears its head again. I won't say whether it's good or bad, but, you know, as we know, even in America, you know, when these legislative laws come out, it does take time for the best practices and clarifications to filter through the system. And, you know, while lawmakers may be well-intentioned, at times they can be disconnected from the underlying problem that they're trying to solve, and the legislation isn't always worded to be as crisp as it can. So I think that's some of what's in here, but this is just going to be interesting to follow. The last one that I had for this week was a continuation of this governance. And this particular one is from this site called NACD, which I had not heard of. I mean, I knew it existed in some form. I just didn't know the name, which is the National Association of Corporate Directors. So basically, there's two links here. The first link really was this thing on a site, Data Matters, where it was talking about cybersecurity, privacy, blah, 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 blah. And basically what they did was they took this paragraph from the slide deck. So I just copied it in here. But it says, privacy and cybersecurity concerns are expanding, and with them the proliferation of laws and regulations, which is why it followed the China article. Boards play a key role in ensuring that companies are positioned to comply with various jurisdictional requirements, that they understand and mitigate related risks, and that they are well prepared to play a key role in response to security breaches and incidents. Indeed, enforcement actions issued by the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission in 2021, including penalties, and that always gets a company's attention, where, you know, a regulation is a regulation until you actually put a penalty behind it, and then all of a sudden it becomes a thing. Due to a lack of senior leadership awareness of the identification and response to security vulnerabilities, sharpening this focus and shed light on regulatory expectations of corporate board oversight relating to privacy and cybersecurity. So within this, the initial article was this very short, you know, blog entry. In here, there is a link. The view article is here, which was actually, and again, I couldn't get the exact site. I don't know if this was a PDF, but It's a short 7-page slide deck, in a sense, where it just talks about, you know, why you need to have these privacy and these data programs in place. They talk about, you know, the different aspects that you need to have where you know, accountability and scope and determine the applicable laws and, you know, putting the pieces together and building on your existing programs and the board's role and blah, 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 blah. And the last one, I just looked this up. It's nacdonline.org. So for those that are more senior roles looking to understand, you know, what these regulations are and, you know, being able to ask more insightful questions, potentially on an interview, this just fell into that whole, you know, if we go back to, you know, the old framework, as it were, this was kind of to me, this was a future of work-esque type article, because this really is impacting how work is going to get done. It's going to have to be done within the confines of these types of regulations. And not knowing, right, the old expression, ignorance is bliss, is not applicable here, largely because there are financial penalties for those that you know, aren't aware or don't conform to those regulations. So that was really the gist of what I had for everyone this week. I started to put some time into my presentation, so I've been a bit distracted, as it were, from my daily reading, even though it does continue. But you know, one of the threads that's coming out into the January pitch is really, you know, there's disruption everywhere. In this particular one, we now see there's a demographic disruption that you know, certain businesses are now going to have to deal with. But I think one of the things to take away from at least today is that some of these disruptions are not necessarily obvious until they are. And it really begins driving the thinking, or at least makes you look like the smarter person in the room, if you're more well-read. I don't want to use the word educated. I'll just use well-read for now. You know, well-read on these topics to say, do these apply, and what is the potential impact of those changes? So rest assured, you're going to see a mention of this type of disruption in the January deck. It's probably going to go in the shock and awe section. But it was just enlightening as I was starting to list out those types of disruptions that we've really talked about throughout the course of these 80 episodes, how many different types that there were. And oh, by the way, you know, they're still talking about other pandemics that are out there as well. So the question is, you know, assuming that these are all the disruptions, what can you do about it? And that's really what's going to come out of the January presentation. So that's what I had for you guys this week. This was more a little bit futuristic, not really futuristic, but a little futuristic in terms of, you know, Facebook with their 10-year plan, human-computer interface, which is a little bit out there, regulation, which, you know, is always there, and that helps define what that helps define parts of what our quote unquote new normal are going to be in the months and years ahead. So, any questions? Guys, we're quiet this week. This was one of those weeks where it wasn't so, it wasn't as actionable as it might normally be, in so much as this was more of suggestions as to how this might change your thinking. So take that for what it's worth. And hello for everybody that did join, and for those that didn't, say hello. So if there's no questions, if there's no pressing anything, I will let you back to your Sunday morning. Again, thank you for joining. And we will do it all again next Sunday. So until then, everyone, stay safe. We'll talk soon. See you then. Bye.